Welcome to the other Mike and Mike show where shoulder dipping is mandatory.
The shoulder dips.
Listen to me, Mike. Your self-esteem is low right now.
The shoulder dips.
You know how stupid that sounds?
The shoulder dips.
Mike. What day is it, Mike?
Well, if you ain't paying, we ain't playing, baby.
Yes, money.
Love money.
You love Pink Floyd, too. You like that? Like a little Pink Floyd intro for you?
It's a gas.
Money's a gas. I'm Mike W.
And I am Mike T.
And this is the Other Mike and Mike Show. This is episode 22, I believe.
I think so, yeah.
That's what you don't want when you're at the blackjack table. It's okay when you sit with us.
Yeah. You don't want a 22.
So welcome to the show. This week we're going to talk a little bit about money. Not a lot about money, just a little bit about money and some of the things that we do today that we didn't do in the past. Obviously, we're going to bring you a shitload of news because that's what we do. We're going to talk about weird news. We're going to talk about not weird news. And we're going to talk about Brian Williams, who's a wackadoo.
Yeah, him and his, what do they call it? False valor, fake valor? I'm not sure what they call it.
Definitely uncommon valor because that's a mess.
Yeah.
He's a disaster. He's made of clay, too, if you ever look at his head. It's funny how somebody that was just so high in life is just like taking off the pedestal so quick.
It's quick, man. It's overnight.
Don't fucking make up stories.
Yep.
That's it. Yep. So let's go right into it. First of all, how's the week been? Week been all right?
Yeah, it's a busy week, man. You know, with the new job, I'm busy all day long, you know? So it's very rare now that I get a couple minutes to myself, except for lunch. But now the week's good, man. And
how do I get a company discount? Because I'd like to add to my sexual bag of tricks.
Not only do I get a company discount, I can get free shit all the time because they have like boxes of samples, boxes and boxes and boxes of samples. Hmm. So I can just – they let me take whatever I want as long as it's a sample. I don't have to pay for anything.
Well, I definitely need some Profos.
Yeah. I'll see if there's that.
They got to be – I only use a certain brand. I'm picky with my Profo. Isn't most guys – I'd be curious about that. You know how you pick your own whiskey? Everybody's got like a certain drink.
Right.
Like when you go to the bar, the more friendly you become with somebody, you know what their drink is, or you know what beer they drink, or you know what I mean? Or you know what their favorite sneaker is. Some guys are Nike guys or Jordan guys. I'm like a Skechers guy. You know what I mean? And then some guys like their Profo. They like what they put on their dingus.
Yeah.
I mean, I have a personal dingus choice. I don't know if you do.
I don't use them.
You don't use Profos?
No.
I mean, I'm a married guy too for 15 years, but I still use a Profo.
Yeah, nope.
I mean, at the point of, you know, you don't use a Profo up to the point where, like, it's either going to be all over the place or it's going to be, you know, blown into a clean dish rag or I have to get a Profo.
Yeah, no.
No Profo, huh?
No. No, it's just, there you go. Yeah.
You're not fixed. You just use them like contraception pills?
No, nothing.
Dude, you're just trying to make a kid?
If it happens, it happens.
Oh, man. That just shows you the D. This is like how we're different and how.
Danger. Stranger danger.
Dude, you're in the danger zone. That's like Top Gun when you pull your penis out.
Yep, I'm playing Russian roulette with my nut.
Wow. Yeah, I can't do that at this point. I don't want no more kids. Not that I don't love my kids today. It's just.
See, we don't have one.
Yeah. Right. Mine are 11 and going to be 10.
Right. We have no kids. So, we would kind of like a kid this year, I think, or try to. But, I mean, you know, we've been together, 5-6 years now? Something like that?
Yeah, that's a, like me and the wife were like that for, God, we got married in 97? No, when we got married. We got married in 99 in September, and we had a kid in 2004. So that kind of makes sense.
Right.
But you're having fun at this point. See, I'm at the point now where I should be having fun, but I don't because, well, I do, but I have to. I have to cover the impact, you know.
Yay, here comes the big boy milk. Yay.
You know what I'm saying? So that's got to be collected somehow.
Got to have careful fun.
I'm not careful until the end. You know what I mean? When you're at the end, when you go, I even go through the coda of a song for any of the musicians out there, and I go back and continue the song. But then when that song ends and you hear the final note, yeah, it's got to be some sort of collection.
Yeah.
And I prefer Lifestyle XLs. Not that I'm trying to be a dick, saying my dick is like a tree trunk. It's just better. And for people that have a tiny dick, listen, Mike and Mike is trying to help the dudes out there to have tiny dicks. Or you have if you think your dick is smaller, and I'm telling you, buy an extra large condom anyway. I mean, unless you have like a peanut.
Right. But you had the extra large condom, it might fall off, and then you might end up getting a little surprise 9 months later that you don't mean to have.
I'll tell you, the thing with the extra large condoms is it gives you a little more room in the tip, so it makes it feel better.
Oh.
The more you know from Mike and Mike.
A rainbow to shoot across my head.
Right. If you have your average, I guess, you know, you throw it out there about, what, 7.5, 8 inches, and you look at the extra large and think the extra large goes to, like, 10 inches, it's probably okay because you get like an inch in the tip, and it just makes it better. There's not that crazy friction there. So it doesn't feel like, you know what I mean, where it has something on, it feels just much better. It's not like a lambskin, which is just disgusting, but I've tried in the past. I just don't like the way they make my, it's like slimy and shit. It's like putting an intestine of a lamb on your dingus. And they're like, expensive. They're like $30 for like three of them. You know, right. It's like $10 a nut when you're doing those, where you can buy at adamandeve.com, which is a competitor of Mike's, and you can buy 100 of them. They're not paying us, but for like $20, how do you beat it?
Yeah, no, it's true.
Yeah, you can. And then when you buy anything from them, they send you like shitloads of stuff, so. Free porn. Not that I'm big into that. I'd rather do than watch.
Yeah.
But I need some free stuff, man. Throw me stuff. And I have a Dexter bag. I can always add to the Dexter bag. You know, I've talked about that before. When you have a good romp, when you just unroll the Dexter bag and you have all your toys out at your display, when you look like either a wild dentist or a mass murderer.
Yeah, I'll see what I can do next week. There's actually a couple boxes now lying out that a new person just kind of brought up with some samples. So I'll go through it. I'll see what's in there, and I'll see you in Dia Care package.
Thank you. That'd be awesome. You can send it to my new address since I'm moving next week.
Which would be amazing. Yeah.
Like a housewarming.
Yeah.
Just put your DNA all over the walls. Mark your territory. I don't know why I even talked about that. That was disastrous, but...
Yeah, I know. It's just...
Extra large profos are the way to go. And if you want to see my snuffleupagus, just ask. I don't mind showing you, especially if we're having like a little drinky drink and we're going to my country house. I'll show you. Maybe I'll show McGaver and Sir Ninja Turtles next time we go up to the country. And we were just saying that how your wife likes board games. You should come up to the country house, man. We'll play board games, get hammered, do right. Some barbecue.
Yeah, I think she'd like it too. I really do. As long as it's tough though. It's tough this year. I mean, we could talk about it offline. You know, don't.
Why is it tough this year? It's free. You don't have to pay nothing. You just come up to the house and you crash.
No. I'm not talking about money. The money's not a problem. I'm talking about because I have no vacation time. Yeah, I just started a new job.
We go up for a weekend.
Well, I mean, I would like drive up on a Saturday and leave on a Sunday. That just doesn't seem...
No, you drive up on Friday after work.
I guess so.
You crash Friday, wake up all day Saturday. We're shoulder dipping.
Yeah.
We're barbecuing. Then you drive back on Sunday. Dude, it's better than not having any trip at all.
No, you're right. You're right.
And I love going at night. I don't mind driving. And the only problem is, you're right. You're much further away. But you can cut across the top of the state and cut your time off. You could hit it from a different angle than I can. We could kind of play that. We could hit it at the same time, just right. From different angles. It'd be amazing.
Oh, yeah. No. That's true. We would just go north because we're only like a half an hour from the New York border.
Yeah. You'll be there in no time. And I'll be hit it from the back. You hit it from the front. We'll Eiffel Tower it and we'll have a great time.
Yeah, it's true. It's like a pair of Chinese goddamn finger cuffs.
Right. It'd be amazing. And we'll throw a little McGaver in there, a little Ninja Turtle, maybe some Sir Cinco, and Jesus Christ, somebody getting pregnant, somebody dying from liver failure.
My wife just might make up pregnant or wake up pregnant, and it's not even Mike.
Right. You might wake up pregnant, and it's Sir Cinco. It'll wake up drunk and half Dominican.
And the baby comes out brown. Like, what the fuck happened
Dude,
that night?
What happened? Where's the coconut you just dropped out of your uterus?
Hilarious.
Oh, it's awesome. So let's talk a little bit about things that, before we get into news and everything else, I want to talk about some things, some observations I've saw this week that I can't remember what the turning point is of when this no longer was a problem or how my thought process changed from kid to not. Almost like when I was a child. I'll tell you an example. When I was a kid, you knew everything. You knew every fucking show. Like, I see my kids today, and they know everything, man. Any kind of pop culture today, they know that better than their homework. I'm like, if you knew this, like you knew, like, Minecraft, if you knew how to do the new math, like Minecraft, right, you might get a scholarship.
Right.
But they know. They come home, they throw the books in the ground, they go upstairs, they're playing Roblox, Minecraft. He's playing, like, Borderlands 7. You know, and he's killing people, and D gets so upset, and I'm just like, I don't give a fuck. And then he's showing me, look, these people are banging. I'm like, you're 11 years old. What are you doing? He's playing, like, Watch Dogs, and he's looking through the cameras, and he's peeping on people. He says, you know that's illegal, right? It's just a video game, Dad.
You're like, no, but the act is illegal.
Spying on people is illegal. Well, that's what the game's about. Go away. And he puts the headphones back on. So he's like, 15 in an 11-year-old body. But when I was that age, you knew that stuff, right?
Right.
You knew about, I mean, when I was that age, I'm sure it'll be a little different for you because there's a little age difference. But I knew, you know, the Atari 2600, and I knew every game known to man. And I knew when I had the first computer where I had a Commodore 64, and I knew all the games, and I was watching TV, and I knew every song, and I knew the top 40 with Casey Kasem, and you knew it all.
Right.
And my mom would buy me albums instead of video games, or before the video games, she would buy me. I had a record player, and I used to tape the nickel to it, and she bought me Rock and Roll Over by Kiss. And I remember my dad saying, is that appropriate? And she's like, Kiss rocks. Why was that not appropriate? Gene Simmons hot. Which is funny when you think of, you flash forward, and my wife is saying Gene Simmons hot. He's older than my dad, which is right, just fucking insane. But, and then when she'd buy me like books, and instead of, and reading the books, and as you're reading the books, the sound effects were on the 45 record. I don't know if anybody else remembers that out there. Like, I had Conan the Barbarian. And it was amazing. But somehow or another, you hit a point in life where you don't know anything about pop culture. And I never thought I would. I used to think my parents are so old. How do they not know? And then life gets in the way. I know nothing, man. I know nothing today. Nothing.
Me either. No, yeah. Not, like, nothing at all. My wife does. But my wife is, I mean, but my wife is younger than me. She's like 7 years younger than me or something like that. So,
oh my God, is she really?
She's still in her 20s, yeah.
Oh, maybe that's why she's so much hotter than you are.
She's so much hotter than I am.
She's so out of your league, dude.
She is out of my league, and I'm very proud of that. I kind of walk around with my shoulders held high, and I'm like, yep, that's my wife.
Man, if she ever wants to step aside, you tell her I'm available.
Right, right.
Sorry, I got off
topic.
Yes,
my wife is hot.
Yeah, scorching hot.
Yes. And, but yeah, like, she knows about pop culture, and she knows, you know, the newer. I don't know anything. You know what I mean? Like, I'm sitting there watching the History Channel, and she's, you know, and she's listening to like pop culture music or watching like, you know, fucking Snooki on TV.
Oh God, stop it, please!
I swear. Sometimes, and it's just like, man, it's like, is this what people watch? Like, is like, I'm trying to learn, you know, like, but. But that's kind of the way that I was raised too, right? Like, my dad and I would watch the History Channel together, or like the Discovery Channel, and sure, we'd watch all that old shit, right?
For sure. I mean, my dad used to read. He still, to this day, and always did, reads a ton of books. And he always, like, you know, people that read are smarter than everybody else. I don't need a super education. I read two. He reads like a book a day, and he'll read like 2 to 5 books a week. But he always would sit, come home. He was a cop. He would sit in front of the TV and not watch the TV and just read.
Right.
That was it. He would just sit there and read nonstop. He always at the library. When he first got the internet, he went to the library online and would get his books, go pick them up. The guy reads. And I still read to this day. And I did work for Penguin Books. I'll put that out there. So I got to meet a lot of authors. And I love to read. But that's kind of lost on people today. I always have a much higher respect for people that read. I know that's weird. It's just it's a crazy thing inside Mike W. But
no, it's not weird. But I never got into reading. You know, I never did. I've read a few books. I just can't. It's not that I don't have the mental capacity for it. It's just I don't get into it. I get bored very quickly.
Yeah, but it depends. You have to find the time. If you don't, some people read for pleasure at home. Some people read during their commute. I don't know. If some people just love to read. I mean, that there's like. And I do. I like it. So,
well, I think that that's something that you have to like. You know, I don't think that anybody can force themselves to start reading books. I think it's one of those things that you either like it or you don't like it. Me reading books was for me to graduate college, and that was it. You know,
that's interesting.
That's it for me personally.
But you know, I would not read back then.
Yeah,
isn't that strange? Like, you know how they make you read in school,
right?
I wouldn't do it.
Right.
I wouldn't do it. I would hustle. I was failing out of college twice because I would hustle guys playing chess.
Yeah.
I would go and play. You know, you always see the guys playing chess in like the little rooms and.
Uh-huh.
I'm a pretty good blitz player. I would go there and I would just destroy them. I still do. I still go to the Chase building once a week in Manhattan on 44th and 6th, and there are always guys in there playing blitz checks $5 a game. I made $40 this week. Went 10-2-2, sat down, made my coffee money for the week. Sat down, just destroyed some guys 6 games in a row. We're playing $5 a game. I had 2 losses, 2 draws, went up. I was up $40.
Nice.
But I was into that and into reading. I guess I was – maybe I was a nerd. Yeah, I guess.
Maybe. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. Back then, I thought that, you know, back in high school or whatever, I might have thought something was wrong with that. You know what I mean? I was a big baseball player. I was a big partier.
I was into all that stuff. The only thing to separate that is that I also had a letter for chess.
Right.
I mean, I was also in the top 10 in the state. So actually, okay. I came in number 9 in the country my senior year. I just lost all my pals that are listening to this just have a question mark above their head. Yes, this is exactly true. And I won the 1988 high school blitz chess championship in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
I got a regular Bobby Fischer here.
I still have the plaque and the trophies. It's embarrassing.
It's not embarrassing. Man, there's nothing wrong with it.
Fuck it. I can still go down to school guys that are just crappy players. I can go there, just destroy them, make $40 a week for coffee.
Right. Right.
But I didn't read books back then because I was just like – I was all into playing music. You know, I was into music and I was in the jazz band and the state jazz ensemble and the state concert band. And I loved classical music and jazz and hated to read. And then once you get older, I was just like, wow, reading's pretty cool. How do these kids not read? How do these kids just watch movies? And they're just like, oh, did you see the movie? And I understand that. I get it because there's sometimes I'm just like, yeah, that's a book I don't really feel like reading. But I kind of like to read.
Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with that. See, I don't. And I've tried at, like, different points in my life, too, right? I was like, well, you know, I'm 35 now. I'll be 36 this year. You know, maybe I would like reading now, you know, because I love to learn shit. I love history. I love, you know, I even love fiction, right? Like, I even love a good story. And I've tried to read, and it's just kind of like, and I just can't quite get into it. I get bored. I get so bored sometimes that I actually forget what happened in the previous chapter. Like, I'll be reading, I'll be like, when the fuck did this happen?
Yeah, that's a disaster.
You like, it happened 4 pages ago.
Would you get, like, a 400 on the SAT?
No, man. I'm actually a smart kid. You know,
I know you are. That's what I'm saying.
I really am. It's just, you know, I'm not, like, boasting. Like, I'm a pretty smart kid. I know a lot about a lot.
I'm a smart guy. I'm just lazy. I had a 1210 on my SAT. I thought that was pretty good.
Yeah, No. That's really good, you know?
For a guy that could care less and was hungover when I took him.
Right, right. I got an 1150.
Right, so we're both not dumb.
Right. And I just can't do it. I can't sit down with a book. I can't read it. That's something that's never changed about me, you know, from like a, you know, from a kid.
I'm not going to hold that against you. That's fair enough.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, where does that cross come in, though? Where do you just said to, like, there's got to be a point in time where you, like, you forget going back to pop culture and reading. And I will tell you, side note, we always talk about joking around. I met my wife August 2nd, 1997. I was engaged at the time. We probably talked about that before. I'm losing my memory as a middle-aged guy.
Yeah, so am I.
And I always say to her, like, we always joke around, like, I said, where's your top 5? And one of them is Gene Simmons. You know, she has a couple guys in there that's just like Steve Perry from the Cherry Papa Daddies. And I told him last month.
You
like,
told me that.
I was so wrecked, dude. I was like, yo, she's in your top 5. She's in the top 5. And I said to her, I said, no, man, nope, I'm a mess. I have so much neurotic nonsense that goes on with me, and I'm overweight. It's a disaster, and I'm a mess. But I said, if I were to have if I build the perfect woman that wasn't the wife and the mother of my kids, she would love hockey, and she'd read, and probably be into rock and roll. Those three things. You would need those three things. And right. I said, yeah, if somebody came out, hit on me out of the clear blue that loved hockey, rock and roll, and like to read, we might have a problem. That would be it.
Right.
And that's a must. But especially travel, forget it.
Right, for sure. Like, I could, like, I love my wife very much, and I would never change her for the world, and I would never leave her, and this and that. And if she hears this, please don't take it personal. But like, if I could like reinvent my wife now, you know, it would be a girl that wears jeans, t-shirts, flip flops, loves to drink beer, watch football, and eat wings all the time, right? Like a girl like that, but also a smart girl. You know, not just someone that,
you need somebody to have some, I got to have someone I can have a conversation with.
Absolutely. But I also want someone that says, hey, why don't you and the boys go away this weekend? Go, you know.
Yeah.
And that bitch is crazy.
And me and the girls are going to go out and get fucked up. And you guys go out and get fucked up. And I'm going to be like, I love you.
Yeah, I hear that. Although my wife doesn't do that. She'll just say, I want you to go.
Right.
And she just stays home with the kids, where I go on like 2 or 3 mancations a year. And I said to her, like, this time I'm trying to plan to go see my pal Chuck. And I'm just, there's a lot going. Life gets so fucking muddy, but at the same time, you got to live. You only get one life.
Right. And that's the way I am. And I try to, you know, sometimes I try to be that way, and sometimes I'm roadblocked, but it's, but like, that's just kind of like my mindset, right? Like, it's like, I don't know how much longer that I have left. I'm not going to be reborn, you know, into like a fucking ant, you know, or whatever like that. Like,
yeah, where you get stomped on by a big dude like me. That's a disaster.
That is, you know, I have one life. Like, I want to live the shit out of it. I want to make as much money as I possibly can. I want to be as happy as I possibly can. And I want to do as much as I possibly can. And if doing as much as I possibly can includes getting fucking drunk all the time, so fucking be it. As long as it's not...
You can't be an alcoholic.
Correct. That's exactly what I was going to say. Like, as long as it doesn't interfere with, you know, ruin my marriage or ruin my job or ruin me.
Right.
Right. But, you know, I don't mean like drinking all the time. Just I like to party sometimes.
Lottie. Dottie, we like to party. We don't
fucking A, and there's nothing wrong with that.
Nobody, yeah, for sure. You know? But I got to give a shout out to the wife for letting me do all this shit. And plus, like I think I told you offline. I don't think we talked about it online here. Is that I got, you know, we decided to go on the 80s cruise next year.
You did tell me that though, which is awesome.
Done deal. It's about a year from now, and they have all these cool bands on there. They have Wang Chung, Flock of Seagulls, Huey Lewis, Richard Marx, Tiffany, you know, all these modern English, Naked Eyes, all those fucking bands from the 80s. And there's a ton. There's like 10 bands playing. And it's cool. You know, it's something different. I got some pals going. So, and I have a girl that I went to high school with, haven't seen. She booked her and her husband. So we're just a whole cool set of folks. And this week they just announced that Was Not Was. Remember them with the dinosaur song?
I do.
They're going to be on board. And Bismarcky. So D said to me, just watching you blow in a 3-2 at a picture of Bismarcky or singing along to Got What I Need is worth the price of admission.
That's amazing. Right? That'll be an amazing situation right there.
But she doesn't, and I've talked about this on multiple shows that I've been on, that it's just crazy to me that she doesn't want to do it on the Kiss cruise. And she's loved Kiss. When I first met her, I was a music major. I mocked it. I was like, what is this nonsense? I loved Kiss when I was a kid, but I didn't think people listened to Kiss after the makeup came off. You know, to me, I was all into the Clash and jazz, believe it or not, because I was a music guy, you know, music major. And she got me back into Kiss, and then we went on the Kiss cruises, and she didn't want to go. And I was just like, that's our thing. What do you mean you don't want to go? And she's like, yeah, I'm tired of, you know, I love all the people there, and they are. They're like family, but they come over, they hug me, and they walk away, and I spend the whole cruise watching you drunk. It's like, I have nobody I hang out with. There's nobody I pal around with. You could just latch on to anybody, and you're the life of the party, and you're hammered, and you're loud, and you love it as much as I do, but you're really into it. You get immersed in that week, and I get that. You know, I don't have a job. I don't have the responsibilities, and I wish there was a way that you could go. And I said, it was a little late now that right. Our fucking booking time came and went, and there's no rooms left. And then last Sunday, my man Eric Pacini called me and said, listen, my wife can't go. I love you like a brother. Would you room with me? Would you leave the home and come? And I was like, absolutely. And I got to tell you, now I'm going on the fucking Kiss Cruise 5. Dude, I am fucking stoked. Baby, it's time. Let me go rock and roll, baby.
You're going to get hammered.
Oh, my God. I'm going to need a liver transplant. Yeah. I've had so many people message me that, holy fuck, I can't believe you're going. Like, youngins. Where, yeah. You know, Beckett has written me like every day. It's just like him and I had mutual erections It's going to be amazing. Then she's going to fly to Florida with the kids after the Kiss cruise, like we did last year, and a whole legion of us Kiss fans invade Disney World.
Nice.
So I'm going to get a rental car. Me and Beckett will go back up there, and we'll hang out with Dee and the kids, and maybe we'll get some other folks to go. I know our pals from Canada are flying in, but it's just very cool. But back to topic. Sorry, I got off topic there.
That's fine.
So when you cross over, and yeah, and like my life back then would never, like when I was in my 20s, I would never want to go on a Kiss cruise. Never. Ever. I'd rather go to Boston, and I hate Boston with all my being, but I'd rather go to Boston and watch like the high school jazz competition because I was in it.
Right.
You know what I mean? Or I'd like to fly to Vegas because I'm going to watch the Herbie Hancock trio. Amazing. For anybody that likes music out there, I don't care what your music genre is. If you see Herbie Hancock, Wayne Shorter, and Ron Carter play together, it's worth anything you could ever see talent-wise on the planet. Trust me. But like one of the other things that we talked about this week is when you cross over is like when we go on a bender. Like when we were young, going on a bender was amazing.
Right.
You go on a bender for like a fucking...
You go for a week.
Yeah. Nope. Eight balling. just drinking. You know, drinking, drugging, just didn't give a care in the world.
Right.
And then like you have one of those benders like I did last year in Atlantic City where you guys took a photo of me when I threw up on Axeman's bed and was passed out between the two beds. And I can't recover from that, dude.
That was like 2 years ago now, wasn't it?
No, that was last February.
Oh.
And that was a day that just I drank all day in Atlantic City. Because, you know, at the time, Axeman was like a high roller. He found Christ. I don't know what happened. He found libertarianism. He went wacko and stopped gambling. But at the time, we were having like free booze all day in like a private club. And then I was shoulder dipped right to see you. You were texting me, and I shoulder dipped right to the B bar where you and I were doing shots of SoCo and beer. You remember that day, right?
I do.
And then I shoulder dipped over to the Gypsy bar, which I banned for from life. You know, I got banned from that place.
Did you really?
I did. There was a mess in there. I punched Rick Nuno in the face. It was a disaster.
Ah.
I was yelling trash at all the fighters going up there, like Lentz and Secor, mess, fail. I went over and put like Heckman in a headlock and messed up his hair. I'm like, dude, no, you're not fearful on any planet. And I was destroyed. And that's when I punched Nuno, I punched a security guy, and I got banned for life. I don't remember any of it. I remember waking up like 2 p.m. the next day between the two beds where it's just everybody somehow that photo circulated with me throwing up all over Axeman's bed and just passed out. Nobody cared if I was dead. They just thought it was the most funniest picture. And then how I found out about it is as our pal, the silencer from the UFC, George Sullivan, puts his arm around me, squats down, and says, bro, I'm going to make a fucking Facebook page to you, and shows me the picture. I'm like, how did you get the picture of me passed out in a room, fully clothed, full of vomit? He's like, dude, you're legendary.
Legendary.
I love you, bro. And he hugged me and walked away.
Yeah, we met up in the B bar.
Dude, I was destroyed.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's the same way. Like, when I went, you know, because, you know, we don't go out often, right? I don't really go out that often anymore. And especially now with the new job, like, I actually understand what it's like to be tired now. And, well, my old job, man, I work from home. You know what I mean? I made a ton of money to stay from home and did do shit. You know, I started work at 10 in the morning. You know, I woke up at 9:47 in my underwear and walked to my desk.
Life was good.
Life was fucking great. But... you know, when I told you about going on the mini-mancation to the Pittsburgh Steeler game with my friend, like that Saturday when we went out to dinner.
Right.
And then we had, you know, quite a few beers afterwards, just going and going and going and going and going and going and going. And we're like, fuck, you know, we got to go home. We want to get up and go to the game and feel okay.
It's tough.
Dude, when we got up Sunday...
You don't even want to go, right? You want to do it like, dude, is it on Fox?
Right. Like, this sucks. You know, I want to, like, scalp my fucking tickets.
I want to watch this on Channel 2.
Right. Like, we got to the game, and I was like, well, like, there's only one thing that's really going to make me feel better. You know, we went and got breakfast, like, bacon and eggs and pancakes and shit like that. And we got to the game, and I was like, well, I was like, maybe another beer will just kind of, you know, hair the dog.
That's it. Calm the dancing hand.
You know, freaking will not make me feel better about myself. And no, man, like it was just a disaster. And then like by the time the game was over, we went, we ate again someplace. I forget where we ate. It was the Tilted Kilt, I think, in Pittsburgh,
God. That's where the girls that can't get into Hooters go work.
Yeah. Oh, my God. It was terrible. The place smelled like vomit.
We have one here in Hoboken.
Oh, do you?
Yeah. I go there every now and then and watch some fights. And
right. The place smelled like vomit. It took forever to get our food.
You see the stretch marks right next to the tattoo, next to the belly button.
Awful, dude. It was just awful. You know, but like we're both just sitting there and you could just see it on our faces. Like
the difference between a Hooters and a Tilt-A-Kilt is you could bang the girls at Tilt-A-Kilt. Like you and I could go in there and just pick them like we're in a harem at Macau. Like, yeah, I want to fuck that girl there. All right, how about? Is there a special wings, bang that bra in the bathroom, and two beers?
And a bucket of beers.
Right. I've got a bucket of wings, a bucket of beers, and a bucket of that girl named Babs over there that's chewing the gum with the stretch marks.
Yeah. That's funny.
It's true.
But we're just sitting there like trying to eat our food, and we're just kind of looking at one another. We're like, fuck, man.
Yeah,
like,
cause you can't recover, man. You get old.
Do it anymore.
And you had a Pittsburgh Steelers jersey on, for fuck's sake.
Yeah, that's a different conversation. You have to understand.
I know. I made fun of you enough on here. At least you didn't have a Penguins jersey on. If you had like a – unless you had – there's a friend of mine that has a Penguins 87 jersey, and the name of the back says Diver. Because Sidney Crosby dives all over the place like a little bitch.
Oh, yeah.
But I don't even want to talk hockey because my boy Lundqvist is out for like a month. He's got like a, he took a puck to the neck. He's got a vascular problem. Our season's over.
Damn.
Yeah, it's just depressing me.
But, yeah, you know, it just couldn't do it, you know. So after we left, we went back to our hotel. We like got a shower. You know, we're like, oh, maybe, you know, maybe a shower will help because, you know, we didn't have to be home until the next day. We're like, man, we don't want to spend the rest of our Sunday night.
Right. No, of course.
Hotel, you know, you want to like do something. So we went home. We showered. You know, we just kind of relaxed. We watched some TV.
Put the Spanktrovision on.
Yeah. We went up to the street about, you know, just right by our hotel. We just kind of walked around until we found like a little dive bar. And, you could still smoke cigarettes in the bar. So it was perfect. And it was just a little dive bar in Pittsburgh. We're sitting there. We're just looking at each other like, I can't do it.
Yeah, I've been there.
You know, it took like an hour for one drink. And like, you know, so we just left. We went back to the hotel and went to bed.
Yeah, I've been there.
Yeah.
Can't do it no more. I remember the when I got hammered after UFC 158 when Jim Miller got choked out by Bam Bam Healy.
Yeah.
And I had $1 million on it, and then it turned into a no contest. I couldn't get my money back from the bookie because once it goes no contest, they don't give a fuck.
Right.
And I got so hammered that night. He had to pull over. That was when Bonnie, Axeman's niece, was holding me up, and I had like her in one arm, my penis in the other, and I was pissing in the middle of the street 3 a.m, like blowing a 7, singing Santeria by Sublime with her. I have a video of it.
Oh, my God.
Oh, it's a disaster. And so I don't know how she held up my 325-pound frame.
Right.
And just urinating all over the middle of the street. Cars are trying to get around me, holding the horn. I was a mess. And then I threw up 3 times trying to get to Axeman's house and then slept on his front lawn. Both doors were open of his car. He couldn't get me in the house. And I just slept on his front lawn. And I didn't really come to until 6 o'clock the next day.
Oh, my.
And I can't do it no more.
No. You know, like this evening, you know, we're probably going to have some friends over and hang out and whatever, have a few beers. Like, I guarantee...
Yeah.
Tomorrow, I'm going to feel terrible, regardless of how many that I have. You know, if it's going to just be all day, like in and out of consciousness all day. But it's just weird. Like my body just can't hang it. You know, just can't take it.
Listen, I'm two Bloody Marys in at 10:13 in the morning. I'm probably blowing a 1-3, and I can't take that. I drank like a half a bottle of Grey Goose this morning. I got on a vodka kick, and usually I'm on Maker's Mark. I'm waiting for Chuck to come here in April. And we'll throw the Maker's Mark down.
Yeah.
You know, Maker's Mark. I still got my bottle of Jameson Black that Axeman got me for Christmas. I got to drink that. I'm saving it. I'm saving it for when the boys are in town or when we have like a housewarming when I move. And
right.
Poker night.
Whiskey I can't do.
Oh, I love whiskey.
I can't do it.
I drink that like water.
Southern Comfort is as brown as I go.
No, I love either Maker's Mark, Jameson. I'll drink any kind of bourbon, any kind of whiskey. The funny thing is we'll have a poker night, and Dee will come in the room. She's so good with that stuff. Anybody need anything? I need another bottle of JMO. This bottle's empty. And I'll sit there and drink like 2 bottles, man. I'll drink like 2/5 in a poker night.
I'd be dead.
I'm like an extra from Hell on Wheels.
Right. Like, I would literally be dead.
No, I can handle it. I'm Irish. I brought up on that. It's like our wine to Italians.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, I drank that at work with some of the guys at work that like drink Hennessy. Know where I'm going with this?
Yep.
And I drank this whiskey straight, like huge glass, and just put the glass down and looked at them, and they're like, "My God, my respect for you just went through the roof." And I'm like, "Dude, that's like water."
Yeah.
It's not like it's an overproof or something.
Right.
And they just look at you like, what the fuck, in awe. Like they just saw a unicorn or an alien.
With you.
The last thing I want to talk about where whatever happened to, it's like I saw some pals. I talked to some acquaintances at work, and people are like, I can't go and do this until my tax return check comes in. When was the last time you looked forward to a tax return check?
Well, I've been a 1099 employee for the past 5 years. So,
do you get money back or do you pay?
I pay.
I do too.
I pay every year.
I don't understand when people are like, you pay? And I look at you like a question mark. I'm like, if you don't pay or if you're getting back a large amount, you're doing something wrong. Or you don't want more money in your check every month, or you don't make enough money.
Right.
And I'm not being judgmental, because when you get judgmental about money, people get weird, and then you lose friends, and you lose, you know, people think of you in a different light. It's just not. It's just the way the world works. I dread tax time. And the people that don't dread tax time, I just scratch my head and be like, I guess I've crossed over.
Yeah, I pay every year. I mean, next year, yeah, I'll probably pay next year too. But yeah.
Oh, I'll definitely pay this year. I paid last year through the ass. Like, it was a disaster.
Yeah.
And I tried to curtail that a little bit. But at the same time, I don't want the government taking my money. And I want to make as much money in my check every check as I can.
Agreed.
And I have, you know, but I'm in a different stratosphere. I make a pretty good penny. You know, I got a raise this week. I was telling you offline.
Yeah.
I make good coin, man. It's just, it's one of those things. And I know that tax time, I got to be wary of that. So, but I want more money in my check. And I don't, and I have a big overhead. You know, I got a wife, two kids. I pay for everything. My wife don't work. But she's a prima donna. She's getting the bass player for Joan Jett, making her hair up pretty every month. You know, and he's like telling me how he's hanging out with Dave Grohl. And I'm like, you know, I could buy and sell you, dude. I don't care if you play bass for Joan Jett.
I could buy and sell you. That's great.
But at the same time, people get strange when you talk about money. It's not that I'm rich, just I make more money than you.
Right.
Or I make a decent amount of money to pay my nut to live in this area, because it's ridiculous. That's why I'm moving next week. I mean, I told you I'm moving next week, and I'm saving like $1,500 a month on rent.
Yeah, I know. It's crazy.
It's insane.
It's crazy.
I just pay my kids' crews off. I pay the 80s crews off, and I'm looking to go to like other things. I told Dave, I said, you get a babysitter again? I'll go to see Motley Crue on the last show. I'd love to do that out in New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously there's a limit, but at the same time, it lets you save money. It lets you do more stuff. I'd rather do stuff than have stuff.
Yeah, I know. Me too. We've had this conversation before. I would rather do stuff too than have stuff.
Right, because it's the memories that you make. But at the end of the day, people get weird, or like they'll think you're going to pick up a check. And a lot of times, I'm fucking broke. Just because I make more than you do, I don't mean I'm not broke. I'm still on a budget. I get paid once a month. I got a lot of overhead. It is what it is. But at the end, there's a time where you get to a certain age where you know you're going to pay on tax day.
Right.
And I don't remember. And I saw somebody say to me, oh my God, you pay? And I looked at them, and my response was, you don't?
Yeah, it's like, oh my God, you don't pay?
I know people get refunds, but those are people that are po.
Yeah.
You know, you need a better job. Come on, dude. What mean you don't pay? I got to wait till my tax return comes in. Then we can talk about going on a trip. I was like, first of all, in the back of my mind, I don't want to go on a trip with you. I have like a handful of guys that I would go on a trip on. They'd probably fit on one hand. Five guys that I'd probably say, yeah, mancation, I'm in. Don't assume that I'm going to go on vacation because you're Adobe head. And if you got to wait for your tax return check to go on vacation, I don't want to do that because I don't want to feel obligated to pick up your bar tab every day. Right?
Right.
I'm not being a dick. If you're my boy and you tell – if you come to me and you say to me, yo, man, I'm a little stretched this month, but I want to hang out. Can we do something a little cheaper? I'll either say, yeah, we can hang out at my place. We'll get the guys there instead, and I'll go buy some bottles. Or I'll be like, don't worry about it, man. I got a little extra coin this month. I'll pick up your bar tab.
Right.
I'd rather you be honest.
Right. Then just kind of say, oh, yeah, hey, let's go on vacation. And then like all of a sudden say,
yeah,
where's my check card? I can't find it. I think I lost it.
Oh, my God. That drives me nuts.
They're the worst.
And usually it's people I don't want to hang out with. I only have about five or six people in the world that I want to spend time with.
Right.
A dudes. You know, seriously. I mean, I'll go here and there, but there's literally a handful of guys that I'll actually want to go and do something with or have them at my place.
Right.
And those guys, they should be able to tell me, yeah, this. But when you know me as an acquaintance and you say, yo, man, I really want to go do this in April, but I got to wait and see what my tax return check is. I just looked at him like he had 10 heads. I'm like, really? If dude, if you're banking on that to like go watch a baseball game, I'm passing because I don't want to pick up the round when it's $12 a beer for three guys.
Right.
And that adds up quick.
It does. It does.
You know, I got to worry about myself getting hammered. I drink more than you fools.
Right. Even like cases of beer nowadays are like going up in price, man.
That's crazy. But like I don't mind
case
that
of
though.
Right? Heineken's for cans is like $30.
I don't mind that. That's weird to me. Like if I knew you were coming and if I had my inner circle of folks coming, like Chuck flying in or, you know, Axe is coming up with T-Baggins or McGaver and Ninja Turtles or it's Cinco. If they're all coming over and I'm just like, yeah, I'll buy like three cases of beer. It's on me. I don't care. I'll get a bottle. It's good.
Right.
That I don't care about.
Yeah, that, you know, that I don't mind either. Like my, you know, like later this afternoon, like my wife and I are going to kind of straighten up the place a little bit. We're going to go shopping. We're going to buy food for tonight. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not going to like charge a cover. You know, I don't mind going.
No, that's retarded. I'll have plenty of booze here for you to drink.
Right.
Just tell me what your drinking choice is. I don't mind supplying it. That's different because I benefit. Because I have good company and life is good. You get good laughs. You get good people. That's what life's about. But there comes a time where I don't. To backtrack, I don't understand how you don't pay.
And yeah. Well, I mean, I guess I know some people that make pretty good money, right? Like pretty decent money. Like in this area, right? If you're making like 40, that's just say you're in this area and you're making $50,000 a year, right? In this area that I live in. That might seem like low to a lot of people that live in certain areas and make a lot of money and work for big companies and stuff.
Make that in a few months.
But like...
Crickets.
But if you're making 50 grand a year here, you are kind of wealthy.
Dude, I could be the king there.
Yeah.
I could be the king of Dula there.
Yeah. Like, I'm serious. Like, you know, it's just cost of living different, you know.
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely.
You know.
I pay $2,800 a month in rent.
Right. I mean, I forget too much what I pay, right? I pay $700 a month.
Dude, my electric bill.
Everything.
Was five bills this month.
Yeah, dude, that includes everything. We don't pay anything. I pay electric, like $20 a month.
Dude, my cable bill was $294.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, my cable, I pay like, I pay like $170 a month for cable, $170 a month for the phone. My rent's like $700, you know. Then we have two car payments, a little over a grand in car payments.
No, I don't have a car. I haven't owned a car since 2006.
Right. So, I mean, it's.
But I still got to pay the food bill for the kids at school.
Right.
I got to pay all of them to get to and from school.
Right. So it's just different, you know.
Absolutely.
There was a time in my life when I had no money, you know.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, you know, we'll talk about this, you know, on a different show because it would be an entire show.
Oh, we have to talk about that as an entire show because I have stories upon stories.
You would be mesmerized.
Dude, I was like homeless. I had to file bankruptcy. We should talk about that on a different show.
Yeah. You know. Like,
but
I
you
was,
change.
It was bad. And I told myself, I'm like, never again. You know, I was raised poor. My parents were poor. I told, you know, then I became very, very poor and in a very bad way. And I'm like, fuck this.
That's a different show for sure. We have stories we could tell forever on that.
Right.
At the end of the day, if you're making a certain amount of money and you're getting checked back, you should talk to me. We can figure that out so you can get more money in your check.
Yeah.
And unless you want that. But at the same time, I'd rather have more money in my check, put that in a different account. And use that money at the end of the year as like a vacation fund.
Right. Well, see, I put like I would never do this back in the day. You know, I mean, this is how I've changed too. Like I put like 35, almost 40% of my check away.
Yeah, you were saying that because you want to be like a millionaire one day. And
every week, I just want like $1 million, $2 million in cash when I retire. That's what I want. And I want to do nothing.
I'll get that when somebody croaks.
Right. Right. So that's what I do. You know, I stash cash, man, every week. Boom, 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 I put it away. Some weeks a little less than others. It just depends upon what bills are due that week, right? If I got to pay the rent and two cars off in one week, I don't put it as much away. But then the next week, if I have no bills, I put more, you know. And it's just the way that I am. But I would never do that, you know, 5 years ago or 10 years ago.
No, I'm exactly. But there comes a point in the way what we're trying to get in point here over the last 45 minutes.
I know, man.
Is that there comes a time where you cross over and just change from the way you were. For the way we were. Can it be that it was lost? Oh, that's bad. I'm hammered. Like, I can't feel my face right now.
We spent so much time on that, we might have to move a couple stories to next week.
Sorry. No, we'll blow through these stories. First of all, we're going to go through, what's his name? Brian Williams, liar.
Man, insane, right?
Brian Williams, a liar. He said he was like shot down a helicopter in 2003. What was even best about this story, when he finally came to and said, I misremembered what happened there. That's like me saying I banged Emma Jameson, and really I was just watching a porno. And I misremembered it. I didn't bang her. I was just watching a porno. Like, I banged my sixth grade teacher, and I didn't. I just rubbed one out into a mitten. And in my mind, I banged her.
Jeez.
Right?
Yeah.
And Tom Brokaw said he knew the whole time this guy was a fucking douche and lying. Good for Brokaw.
Yeah. I actually didn't even know about this. Like, I had seen, like, some things going around about him. I wasn't really paying attention. It was kind of a, you know, and it was... You told me. I'm just like, what the fuck?
Yeah, just like he made all these statements saying that he was in Iraq like a dozen years ago and there was a crisis and he was hit by a rocket-propelled grenade and the helicopter went down. And they're like, yeah, no, I misremember. That was the helicopter in front of me that went down. And even the guys, the Army guys, are like, what's this fucking wackadoo talking about?
Right.
And he fucking held on to that for 12 years. And now it's come out and he's admitted that he didn't realize. But to me, it's like, come on, dude. Come on.
Right.
Not that I care, but you come across as so arrogant sometimes. I hate watching news in general. I like watching, and listen, I do. I watch like Good Day New York just because they're dopes. And I get to tweet with Mike Woods, and he'll tweet back. I ask him if he was on True Blood because he hasn't aged since I watched 20 years ago. And he'll tweet right back like, thanks, man, or yeah, bro, it's like good skin products. And I can't tell if he's gay or not. Not that it matters, but. He's a strange cat. That's the only reason why I watch the news, just because somebody reacts to me on Twitter. But Brian Williams, he can go fuck himself, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, like you see all the time, like these videos, like these Army Rangers and things like that, that like record these fake heroes
right
online and then post it online. Like, this is like the same thing, but it's like a major, major man in the media industry, you know, like one of the top dogs. And stolen valor, that's what they call it. And he said stolen that he was this, and this, and... He fucking wasn't. He's a fucking liar. Fire his ass.
We have, if Brian Williams was in the UFC, here's his theme song. And I'm an asshole, yo, 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 yo. I'm an asshole,
yo, but you're an asshole. Brian,
I eat cock for breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
He's a fucking cunt.
You know, there's a clip right there.
He's a fucking cunt.
That's a great clip.
He is. He's a fucking cunt.
Yeah, but that sound drop right there.
That is a great sound drop, and you could use it for...
A million things. And the same guy gave me...
You can't deny greatness. You just can't.
That is Sleepy Pie Jones, my pal. And I still talk to him every now and then. He used to be the bass player for the number 13s, and that was from Kiss Cruise 2. Amazing, right?
Right.
That guy's amazing. Number 13s all day. Check them out.
I will.
Great band. Good friends of mine. Anyway, Brian Williams, go fuck yourself.
Yeah.
So we're not going to spend a lot of time on him today. You saw the King Abdullah from Jordan. First of all, the guy being burned alive, the Jordan pilot who was burned alive by ISIS, it's unwatchable.
It's ridiculous.
It's unreal. What's even more unreal is King Abdullah's wife and how goddamn hot she is.
I freaking haven't seen her.
Oh, my God. Let me send this to you right now. I'll copy, paste.
I'm just going to Google.
No, I'll right here. I'm putting it right in the chat.
Queen Rania or Rania of Jordan?
Boom. Just click on that. And Jonas Cespedes, the baseball player, actually tweeted, King Abdullah is also a major general in the Special Forces, and this is his wife. Like, that to me. Look at how beautiful she is.
Yes.
Right? Ridiculously hot.
Yeah.
And he looks like the guy from, like, Restaurant Steakout. Like, he's Big Willie from Big Willie Steakhouse.
Right.
But at the same time, you know, they burned him. And if you didn't hear the story, the King Abdullah from Jordan, I mean, anytime you have Muslims, and listen, I'm not being racist this week, but anytime you have Muslims in a Muslim country chanting shit against other Muslims and not bad-mouthing the United States, that's a win for the world.
Right.
To me, that's a win-win. And you know, that's a problem for ISIS. I think they've crossed a point now where you can't go and just attack another Muslim-based country. And they're an ally of the United States. And he seems like a cool ally, not like a... You know what I mean? He's like the Muslim that we should all get along and be the melting pot in a perfect world of what America should be. He's like that guy. Yes. And he's kick ass too. So he was in Washington D.C. when this happened, when they burned the pilot from Jordan. ISIS burned him and killed him, and he heard about it. And I don't know. He went and told people, one of the representatives of Congress and a couple other people. I don't know if you saw this, like a quote from Unforgiven, but he had to say something similar to this.
Any man I see out there, I'm going to kill him. Any some bitch takes a shot at me, not only going to kill him, I'm going to kill his wife, all his friends, burn his damn house down.
That's pretty much what he told them.
Yeah, he's but actually, like, I was reading some things, and they had actually done this to this guy, burned him and whatever, tortured him, because they were trying to do like hostage negotiations or something, or wanted money or something.
Right.
They had actually killed him and filmed this before they even started the negotiations.
Dude, that's unbelievable.
So this guy was already fucking dead, and they were, you know,
unbelievable
to negotiate for him. And when that. And, like, dude, like, this is how sadistic these fucks are. They, like, professionally shot it and edited it. You know, it was like a...
Disgusting.
It was...
It just shows you the level of depravity that's going on with these folks.
Fuck them. You know what I mean? Like, I'm tired of it. Like, you have these sympathizers and this. You know, go fuck yourself, too.
We'll set you on fire.
Seriously, yes. I will set you on fire, and you let me know if you're still a fucking sympathizer.
I think Rage Against the Machine needs a new album cover.
Yeah.
We'll set you on fire. We'll put it right in the front of the album.
Yeah, if you sympathize with these assholes, you can go fuck yourself and don't talk to me ever again.
But I will tell you, for King Abdullah, he went home, he got inside one of the fighter jets, and he led a bombing raid. To me, that's a fucking man. Dude, that's standing up for the country, that's country pride. We got a dopey head president, not to get on soapbox, who I fucking can't stand, who's just a dope. And he gets up there talking about the Crusades. Dude, have some balls. Lead the country. Do something. This
right.
guy goes home, puts on the fatigues, gets arm in arm hugging his guys, and he's going there. He's killing people. He backs up the words. You know, fucking. I can't say enough about King Abdullah from Jordan. This is why. This goes out to him.
Well, you can tell everybody. Yeah, you can tell everybody. Go ahead and tell everybody. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. Yes, I am, yes, I am, yes, I am. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man.
He's the man.
He is the man, and you would never see any of these American politicians do anything like that.
A bunch of pussies, Christ's
sake. The majority of the countries of the world, not just America, I guess, you know, not to just bash them, because I will bash them any time, because our current administration are a bunch of fucking
it's
douches.
Awful. But, Eric Holder should be tried for treason.
Right. And the majority of these countries, like, they would never do that. You would never see a president hop into a plane and go fuck some shit up.
And first of all, don't start saying, oh, you're a fucking Republican scumbag. I'm an American.
That's it. You know, when people ask me, like, where I classify, like, I'm in the middle, man.
I love everybody. I don't care if you're black, brown, yellow, gay, cripple. I don't give a fuck. We're Americans.
Yeah.
I think everybody should have equal rights. I think there's got to be a way to get along. I think we need to help our people who can't help themselves. As long as they try to help themselves, there's got to be a middle ground to everything. I understand having guns to hunt. I'm not crazy right side, crazy left side. I'm American. When somebody starts shitting on us, somebody's got to be the guy who punches the chest and gets in the fucking Hornet and bombs people.
Right.
Or show some sort of balls.
Right.
Or I don't care if you're male or female. I would vote for a female president if she wasn't a douche.
Yeah.
Or a dopey.
Yes, Hillary Clinton.
Either side of the fence. I'm not trying to play either side of the fence. If we had somebody who was intelligent and had some shoulders and put them up, I'm all in.
We have nobody like that. We have nobody like that even attempting for the next presidency.
Oh, man, the softest cotton. You got just Jeb Bush, come on. Hillary Clinton, disastrous.
Everybody wants to fucking cuddle and pay money, and it's just...
Maybe Liz Warren, but she's a little out there, too. And then you have... Chris Christie. You need like a Republican and a Democrat to get together, run together in the same ticket, all of us get along and find ways where it's not backroom deals. And I know it's an impossible dream.
Right.
But if there's a way to combine the both parties to have a government that actually works for us, with us, gets the laws right, doesn't trample on religion if that's what you care about, which I do not.
Me either.
But it's a hard, you're never going to make everybody happy, but you got to make the majority happy.
Right.
And we don't have that today. But we, Jordan does.
And they have a boss, a motherfucking boss for a president.
Just insane.
He's a beast.
I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. Yes, I am, yes, I am, yes, I am. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man.
He's the man.
He is. And his wife is hot.
His wife is ridiculously hot. Like, I would pay. I think I would pay good money to go there.
Come on down here and let me tap that ass.
That's all. All I need is like 37 and a half seconds.
Yeah.
Right?
Excellent.
That's it. That's all I need. Then I'll just be blowing my load.
Yep.
Anyway. Moving on. We got some time here. We got like another 10, 15 minutes. We'll go through the news stories. I'm not even going to play songs. I'm going to go right. Well, give me your first news story. You got news stories, right?
Yeah, hit look me. At this motherfucker.
Let's hear it.
This kid.
Kid?
Guy. Child. Man child. Retard. I don't know.
You're in more dire need of a blowjob than any white man in history.
This guy. I mean, the title of the article is Comic Book Fan Chops Off His Nose to Look Like a Captain. The Captain America villain Red Skull, right?
Right.
And you've seen this, right?
Yeah, the guy.
Uh-huh.
He's like changing his face.
When they do the side-by-side, it's a terrible job. He looks like a character from Star Trek, not even Red Skull.
My pal, the Ant-Man, my pal from the Kids Cruise, he wrote, he looks more like a Klingon, fail.
Yeah.
I
mean, this guy chopped his fucking nose off. He had these things implanted under his skin. I'm not sure if that's a tattoo on his face.
What?
I mean, it's a disaster. And
he what the fuck do you do that for?
And what was one of the tweets here? It was hilarious. This guy will do anything to look like Red Skull except apparently shave.
But you got to think that. Like, imagine he does that and he goes and shows his wife or his parents.
What the fuck you do that for?
That's what I would be saying.
Get the fuck out of my house.
What?
Or dad.
What is this faggot crap?
I really hope he has a bunch of money saved because nobody's going to fucking hire him.
This shit's weak. Shit's weak.
That's terrible, dude.
I mean, nobody's hiring this man.
He took neck tattoos to a whole other level.
Yes. This guy is fucked.
Disastrous.
No.
That's terrible. Yeah, so look that up. Look up the guy that's trying to be Red Skull. What a fucking disaster.
Disaster.
What else you got?
I got Martina Biggs implants.
Okay.
Bumper size up to 32 large. So Ooh. Let's just go ahead and listen to this.
Jesus.
German model Martina Big gave up her high-flying career as an air hostess to focus on increasing the size of her chest. Her motto is big is not big enough. And her breasts are so big, in fact, the Germans don't actually have a size for them.
Ich war also vorher auf 70D. Jetzt habe ich also 32K.
She said, in the beginning I was a 70D, now I'm a 32K.
Ich bin also auf britische Größen umgestiegen, weil also
70K does not exist.
Die Körpergröße in Deutschland endet bei G. Und deswegen bin ich also auf britische BHs umgestiegen.
And they're only set to get bigger, as her implants allow her to add more volume without further operations.
So, for those of you who can't see the video, it's a video, and I apologize for her speaking in German. There was fucking subtitles on
Do not, because her talking in German.
There's an actual, like, tube that she can plug into her boobs. That she can pump them up with, like, a little air syringe.
The fuck are you doing?
To make them bigger. To keep making them bigger.
Jesus.
I mean, this girl's fucking boobs.
More than a mouthful.
Are huge. And that doesn't interest me.
If you want to bang that weird woman one more time for the memories, I will allow it.
I mean, if, like, you're naturally that big, it is what it is.
Nobody's naturally that big.
Oh, but I'm just saying, like, it's okay if you're naturally that big. But if you're purposely doing this.
Right.
I don't get it. No, I don't get the luster of it.
I do. I love it.
You love it? You love those big fake 72K titties?
I got to see them. I mean, I just heard the voice. I need the rest of it. I mean, we got to take a look at that. You got to send me the image.
Yeah. You'll.
So what's the end game there for her?
I think it's just having
Right. Dark
breasts.
I don't know. That's weird. It's a weird end game. There's nothing to gain from that.
Nothing. She has nothing to gain from it.
Just ridiculously huge.
Just ridiculously huge boobs. I mean, she's got a boyfriend. They've spent $56,000 on plastic surgery so far.
Disaster.
That's
a disaster.
Right. I mean, I'm reading here, and there's really no end game for her. I mean, she's 5'6", man. She's 5'6".
It's all boob.
All boob.
Okay. I can be into that, I guess. I need to see the picture.
Yeah. It's just a disaster, and I'm going to send it here to you, but...
While you're doing that, I'm going to play the next thing here. I got I was telling you about this offline. Another Florida nonsense. The Dolphin Love movie? The Dolphin Lover?
You told me a little bit about it.
So there's a documentary called, you can look this up, dolphinlovermovie.com, where a guy falls in love with a dolphin, and now he's making love to this dolphin daily, it seems like. But here's a clip.
This is Florida, land of flowers, orange groves, beaches, gunfights, riding porpoises.
I first discovered Florida land as a tourist, being taken there by my...
It all started at Central Perk when a runaway bride stormed into the place.
What was that?
That would be an advertisement from something.
What happened there? There we go.
My parents in the mid-1960s, I remember shooting some home movies, seeing the dolphins splashing around in their pool, the Indian fire eater, the Western shootout, all the tacky treats that they had there.
Bottom line, this guy goes to Florida. Let me get to the end of this. What the hell is it?
My name is Malcolm J. Brenner, and this is the story of how I fell in love with Dolly the Dolphin.
There you go. So he does a whole movie how he fell in love with Dolly the Dolphin. You're speechless.
And he has sex with this dolphin.
He destroys it. The comments here are just like, for the love of Christ, what happened to our country? How is this a movie?
I mean, that's definitely self-financed. I mean, I don't think anybody made that movie about him.
I don't think it's Miramax.
Right.
I would bet the house it's not Miramax.
Right.
Anyway, take a look at that. Tell us what you think of that. And if you love dolphins, I don't want to hear about that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't care if you love dolphins or not.
Yeah, but you can wax a dolphin when you're at Nassau in the Bahamas.
Yeah. I mean, I don't want to hear about a guy fucking a dolphin.
Right, putting his penis in the blowhole.
Yeah, I mean, who wants to hear about that? Not me.
No. What I do want to hear about is this whole... You heard about this woman with the bumblebee tuna can?
I saw it, and it freaks me out a little bit.
This woman opened a can of tuna, and it had some kind of creature in it. And they're saying they don't know if it was a shrimp head or a crab head. I don't know if you saw it, but if I opened up a can of tuna and saw that thing with eyes looking at me, dude, I would freak out.
Bumblebee tuna. Hi there, nice to see you. Bumblebee tuna? Bumblebee tuna! Ace Ventura, pet detective. How are you this afternoon? All righty then. Excuse me.
Your balls are showing.
Bumblebee tuna?
Bumblebee tuna. Yeah, and you saw it. You saw it with the head.
I did. And there was actually another article that I saw that said that it might be like a tongue-eating something. I forget what the hell that they called it.
Stop.
I swear.
Stop it.
It's like a – I forget what the fuck it is. But
that's disastrous. I don't even want to think about it. You know, I don't even want to think about it. If I opened up a can of tuna and I saw anything with eyes in it, dude, I'm retching.
It is what it is.
I'm retching.
It's not maybe. It is.
It's disgusting.
Mystery tuna creature is tongue-eating parasite, says expert.
What the F?
Yep.
How is that looking at me when I open up the can? Is it alive?
No. It is. I don't know, but it is. It's like, it looks like an alien, doesn't it?
Yeah, you chop up some celery, mix that with some little mayo in there, next thing you know, your tongue's gone.
Oh, man, that is a bad fucking day.
That's disgusting. That's like a thing from Mars.
It is. Like, it really does look like an alien.
Dude, I'm going to be sick.
Yeah.
I'm going to be sick. Moving on. So we talked about a dog getting killed by a neighbor not too long ago. Remember that story?
I do.
Here's another one where a vet took a dog and did something that the vet wasn't supposed to do.
A Florida veterinarian removed a dog.
Anybody surprised it starts a Florida veterinarian?
It's been a while since we made fun of Florida.
Dog's eye without the owner's consent. According to WTSP, Kimberly Hayden dropped her 13-year-old pug, Chloe, at the Banfield Pet Hospital in St. Petersburg, Florida, for a follow-up appointment after being prescribed medication for a cloudy eye. She even filled out on the form stating she was there only for a follow-up and that she would have to give permission for any procedure costing more than $5. But when she received a call from a staff member, she got some troubling news. Here's Hayden speaking with WTVT.
Around noon, I get a phone call, and the girl on the phone says, I just want to let you know that Chloe's doing well. She's recovering well from surgery. I started shaking. I think I even stopped breathing for a minute, and I kind of just was like, excuse me, what are you talking about? She's supposed to be there for a follow-up.
The animal hospital admitted their mistake, releasing a statement saying, although the care provided was medically necessary based on the severity of her condition and lack of response to therapy, we did fail to get surgical authorization from the client on the day of the procedure. However, we had previously discussed the need for surgery with the client.
First of all, they took the pug's eyeball out. The dog's walking around like Sammy Davis. It's like Sammy Davis pug. Pugs are weird anyway. And now this pug is one of the one-eyed Altoon Sammy Davis pug.
So the dog went in for a follow-up and came out with one less eye.
It went in for a follow-up, came out singing Mr. Bojangles.
That's awful.
You should see the dog looks hideous, dude. It's got like a vagina where the eye was. It's just all fucking mangled. Kind of looks like the thing that used to be on Drew Brees' face.
Oh, no.
Now it's on. They took it off of Drew Brees. They put it in his eye socket. This poor dog. And they always look like, they just look weird. They got that whole Igor, Marty Feldman look, pugs, and this thing has just got one eye now. It's just very strange.
So are they suing this vet?
I had no idea. I would assume. See what this says.
While Hayden admits that last part of the story is true, she specifically told the vet not to go through with the surgery, and she just wanted to stick to the medicine. And now she's spreading her story on Facebook in the hopes of preventing something similar from happening to another dog.
If I can do anything with what happened to us yesterday to help others,
dude,
then unfortunately this is a bad thing, but we did good from it.
Hayden is considering taking legal action against the animal hospital.
Dude, it looks like The Walking Dead. It looks like Rick Grimes' dog.
Oh, my God.
That tongue-eating parasite found its way into this dog's eyeball.
I just don't understand.
It's disgusting.
I mean, how can somebody fuck up like that?
It's Florida.
It's true.
It's Florida. I have one more story to talk about. You have anything else before I go into the last one?
No, I don't. You can shoot.
All right, last story I got for this week, Teddy Love. I don't know if I played you this, the Teddy Love sex doll.
I didn't.
So Teddy Love is a sex toy that's more than you can bear. That's the tagline anyway. It looks like it's a stuffed bear toy, but the nose is like a vibrator and the tongue is like a clit flick. I'm speechless too. I got a little clip.
Big star of this year's show is a creepy little teddy bear / vibrator hybrid named Teddy Love.
And it goes 10 speeds. So put your hand on his nose and tongue. My.
The Teddy Love doll is the perfect gift for the lady in your life who's always wanted to get freaky with a stuffed animal.
What do I like to do to her? Something I call a dirty fuzzy. Are you laughing now?
Are you laughing now? But enough with the jibber jabber. Let's get down to the nitty gritty and uncover the bare necessities of how to get bare naked. Let's find out how this bear f***s you.
Let me ask you a question. How do we turn him on?
Just squeeze Teddy's right ear to turn him on. Squeeze the left ear for 10 speeds, 5 fixed and 5 variable to make him go like a jackhammer.
Come on, God. I want an ear-operated vaginal jackhammer.
You want me to show you the different positions?
Sure.
Okay.
No, I don't want to even watch this anymore. I'm going to be sick. First of all, the woman they're showing the positions to is like 79 years old. She looks like she ate the Golden Girls. watching her get off on a Teddy, on like Ted, because that's what this, in theory, this is what this is. This is like the movie Ted, except the thing burrows between your legs. Dude, I'm disgusted. At the same time, turned on, and my behind's moist.
Now, what is the website for that again?
Do you really want it?
Oh, no, never mind. I got it. No, I just want to get the pictures for the...
That's the Teddy love.
For the episode cover.
All right, listen, it's time to wrap this shit up.
It really is.
God have mercy. Thanks for tuning in. Go to theothermics.com. Check us out. Everything on there. Like our iTunes page, Stitcher Radio. Interact with us on Facebook, facebook.com/theothermics. And tell somebody. Do us a favor. Tell a friend. Big shout out to ADO Radio because they're always giving us a plug.
Always.
Attention Deficit Order Radio. Check them out. Check me out on CodoMMA.com on Monday nights, 9 p.m., 11 p.m. Eastern. You can hear us live. You can also punch in through our mix, MIXLR.com, and just look up Knights of the Octagon. You can talk with us or just check out the podcast. Yeah. Oh, my God. I'm spent after a couple of those news stories there.
I know. Like, I feel like a little odd about things now.
Jesus Christ. Anyway, I'll tune in next week. Until then, I'm Mike W.
And I'm Mike T.
And everybody, remember, King Abdullah is the man, and I'm going back on the Kiss Cruise. Bitches!
I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. Yes, I am, yes, I am, yes, I am. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. I believe every lie that I am.
Tell the man the rock and roll gang, yeah!
Mike, what day is it, Mike?
Believer's got the feeling, believer wants to show, believer wants to tell, believer rock and roll, yeah, yeah.
You are nothing. If you were in my toilet bowl, I wouldn't bother flushing it. My fat fat means more to me than you.
It's goddamn delicious.
On a penis. I like to suck a dick where I feel like I'm in power.
The next morning, I still wait for flight in the city that ain't.
I gotta wet my beak.
last night. They don't slap, they don't flip, and they don't dip.
Come on down here and let me tap that ass. Come on down here and let me tap that ass.
What a special friend you are.
What am I doing on this meat?
This is about sex that makes me have to cry out.
Can't deny greatness. You just can't.
You pull my face closer to your massive erection.
Just love you!
You naughty, naughty boy. You're so fucking turning me on, baby.